Welcome to the European Podcast. In this episode, we discuss the European Parliament's action regarding the LGBTIQ community in the European Union. My name is Kamila Wilczyńska and my guest is Ms. Kim van Sparentak, member of the European Parliament from the Greens, European Free Alliance, climate and social justice activist. It is my great pleasure to host you in our virtual studio. Last Monday was an International Day Against Homophobia, Biphobia and Transphobia. As every year, on this occasion, ILGA Europe published an annual index of European countries assessed in terms of LGBTIQ rights and living conditions. For the second year in a row, Poland is in the last position in the entire European Union, on the 43rd place. The Netherlands, on the other hand, is situated definitely higher in the 16th position. Could you please describe how the situation of the LGBTIQ community looks like in the Netherlands?
Yes, and thank you so much for the invitation. We of course know the Netherlands is well known for their LGBTI rights, and I guess mainly because we were the first country worldwide in 2001, so it's our 30-year anniversary, to legalize marriage equality. And, you know, if you look at the context of that, only 28 countries worldwide have legalized same-sex marriage, and only 16 EU member states have. So we were really the front runners. But that doesn't mean we are there, you know. It's not the place to be for LGBTI people. And there are still both institutional and societal issues that you face when you are a member of the LGBTI community. If we look at the acceptance of people from the community, most people will say that, you know, they accept LGBTI people. I think about 90%. But then one in three people would in a survey say that they prefer not to see it in public. So, you know, there's always this discrepancy between, you know, what people say and what they actually feel about certain things. Also, if we look at, you know, physical violence, unfortunately, also in the Netherlands, we see it is increasing against the LGBTI community. And there's still quite some legislation that is still not in place. Take, for example, a discussion that is very long ongoing already in the Netherlands about multi-parent families. There's still no proper solution for that. But also there are still some issues around the rights of transgenders. But looking at many other countries in the world, we have already come a long way. I can just say that we're not at the end of our fight yet.
So now we know what is the situation like in the Netherlands, but let's look a bit broader at actions undertaken by the European Parliament. As the member of the European Parliament, could you tell us more? What does the European Parliament do to successfully fight with discrimination across the continent?
Well, I guess the European Parliament does a lot of things, not only on Ida Hot, but on many days. And of course, this year, everything around, you know, celebrating or, you know, mourning things happening in the LGBTI community is happening virtually and in a very different way. You know, we've also seen that most prides have been cancelled or have been moved online. Transgender Memorial Day was moved online. So also Ida Hot was moved online. You know, there were many different actions in different member states. In Belgium, for example, there was the request to wear purple against hate against the LGBTIQ community, which some of us joined. And of course, we have a strong alliance with ILGA. So we also paid a lot of attention to the publishing of the rainbow map, which they publish every year. What we are doing in the European Parliament is actually to provide a space for people from the LGBTIQ community to feel represented if they have, you know, a national government that doesn't represent them or a regional government. Take, for example, the situation you have in Poland. Many people from the LGBTIQ community, they get hate threats and not only suffer hate speech from their community, but also from politicians. And then I think it is our job in the European Parliament to show them that there are elected representatives that represent them and fight for their rights. So that is, I think, one of the very important things we do. On a more institutional level, we work on improving legislation, specifically anti-discrimination legislation. The Commission has published a first ever LGBTIQ strategy and has several pillars. And one of the, in my opinion, most important pillars is tackling discrimination against LGBTIQ people. And there are some specific pieces of legislation that we can actually use to tackle discrimination. One is the Horizontal Anti-Discrimination Directive, which has been blocked in the council for over 10 years, which would actually mean that, you know, people from the LGBTIQ community can't be discriminated against anymore when they're looking for a job, for education, or a house. But, you know, we can also look at anti-discrimination based on hate speech. And there is new legislation coming up against hate speech. And we really hope that we can expand, you know, the scope of this legislation as much as possible. The idea is to make hate speech and hate crime illegal in the whole EU. And we really hope that we can also, you know, include discrimination and hate against LGBTI community. But unfortunately, we do see that some countries like Poland and Hungary continuously block any EU proposals regarding LGBTI rights. So it's going to be a hard fight to fight still. Another problem, of course, is that we still don't have mutual recognition in every EU member state for rainbow families to travel and for rainbow couples, which is something that, you know, we continue to fight for. And, to, you know, if you're married in one country and you have kids, it's just incomprehensible to imagine that if you are a family with a same-sex couple and you go to another country, that suddenly, you know, your parents are not considered your parents anymore just because they are same-sex. So that is something we really need to change. Personally, I'm very much engaged also in digital affairs. And I think that sometimes it's underestimated how much the Digital Services Act can also make a big difference. You know, as I said before, during COVID, a lot of the work of the LGBTIQ community has moved online. And we've also seen an increase in online hate speech and online hate targeted specifically at the LGBTIQ community. And it's very important that we ensure that not only offline, but also online, there are safe spaces for people from the LGBTIQ community. So if we make sure that we get better notice and action rules, and we ensure that people don't stand empty-handed when they have been suffering hate speech online when they go to a platform, but we actually have, you know, an in-dispute settlement court, or, you know, or we have, you know, a judge that actually can see what's happening rather than a platform. We can actually really improve the safety of the LGBTIQ community online.
You mentioned the European Union LGBTIQ strategy. Could you tell us what does this strategy bring to the European Union policy on equality and LGBTIQ protection? Which of its main pillars will be the greatest challenge for the countries, and which countries?
Well, I think the anti-discrimination pillar is, you know, is one of the most important, but it's also one of the most difficult ones. You know, discrimination against the LGBTIQ community is very difficult to discuss because in certain countries LGBTIQ is considered an ideology, and there is a huge campaign and backlash against, you know, the freedom of people within the LGBTIQ community, which is, of course, it's incomprehensible because, you know, it's not a choice. You know, it's you fall in love with someone or you are someone, and it is pushed aside as some ideology. Tackling, you know, this from a European level has to go hand in hand with supporting, you know, the LGBTIQ community and activists on the ground, and also in trying to change the mindset of the people. Because if we want to have proper legislation on a European level, we have to have also support from that on the ground. And I think it's going to be really challenging for Poland and Hungary to take them on board, because we just see that, you know, they have institutionalized hate speech against their against the LGBTIQ community as one of their main pet stories. So it's a bit, I think that's going to be a tough challenge, but we can't tolerate it. And also, I'm also very much in favor of having infringement procedures against these countries that are, you know, systematically discriminating against the LGBTIQ community.
The pandemic and long-lasting lockdown have affected profoundly various aspects of our lives. How would you comment the influence these factors on LGBTIQ community in Europe? Have you observed any significant positive or negative changes?
You know, I think there's no data yet, but there is already a lot of, you know, anecdotal evidence that, you know, the pandemic and the lockdown have been incredibly hard for people from the LGBTIQ community. On the one hand, as I said before, we couldn't get together. We couldn't celebrate who we are on Pride. We couldn't talk with other people about the struggles we're facing in a safe space somewhere. So, and you know, the LGBTIQ community is called a community for a reason. You know, we support each other and we stand together when we are struggling. Another very important factor, of course, is that we've seen an increase in, for example, domestic violence. And it's very important that, you know, we acknowledge this and also, you know, imagine being LGBTIQ, still living at home, not being able to go to school, and then having parents that don't accept who you are or who you love. That is very hard for kids in the community. And then not being able to go anywhere or to go to school or meet with friends, you know, it's been really tough for young people in the community. Another issue that we see is that also the waiting lists for regular healthcare, of course, have gotten longer, and that also includes, you know, mental health, but also includes, you know, trans care, for example, and intersex care, which is very very difficult. If you already have to wait for a long time, and these waiting lists increase, I think that is you know, something we really have to work on to shorten these lists. And one of the things that we are very afraid of is that there's going to be also many more people who have become homeless. It's very difficult, of course, to measure, but we know that I was a rapporteur on the housing, decent and affordable housing in the European Parliament. And here we also focused a lot on homelessness. And there's actually an increase in LGBTIQ youth in the homelessness community. They're a very big part, because on the one hand, you see that young people already have a tough time finding a house. Then secondly, we see that young LGBTIQ kids get kicked out of their homes when they come out sometimes. And then thirdly, you know, it's because of we don't have proper anti-discrimination rules. They're often also discriminated against when they want to get a house. So it's very important that we keep monitoring what is also happening with this community, because we are expecting, because of the COVID crisis, an even higher increase in homelessness. And we really have to make sure that the LGBTIQ kids that are suffering homelessness are not being snowed under.
A recent court ruling in Zagreb criticizes discrimination against same-sex couples in the adoption process. Do you think that such decisions of courts are the result of cooperation between European Union countries? Do the measures by the European Union really help societies in the member countries to improve the legal situation of the LGBTIQ people?
Yes, absolutely. You know, we have to recognize that, you know, starting a family and being who you are is a right that everyone should have. And the more that courts actually say, yes, this is the case, not only because of moral reasons, but also because it says it in the law, you can't discriminate against people. I think it is very important. It's already a very important sign for the LGBTIQ community, and also, you know, just shows to people that it's not just, you know, some nice thing to have on your wish list, but actually it's based on law and legislation, which I think is a very important signal to give to everyone in the world. And, you know, when we're talking about same-sex adoption, you know, it's just part of the right to start a family. So I think it's very important that these court rules are done, and also that luckily, we have been proven right many times.
Could you tell us more about the initiative called LGBTIQ Freedom Zones? How significant is this declaration and how will it contribute to the improvement of the LGBTIQ situation?
I think it is really important that we have done this. You know, we see that there's more and more places, and especially in Poland, of course, that have declared themselves an LGBTI-free zone. And this is just, you know, systematic hate against the LGBTIQ community, which is 100% intolerable. And I think it is very important for people from the community that here you are not welcome here, you shouldn't be here, to have other people that represent them, like in the European Parliament and in the European Commission, tell them, well, we represent you and we will make sure that you are safe. You are welcome in the European Union and we will make sure that you have all the rights that you deserve. And I have spoken also with many activists from the communities that are, you know, in these LGBTI free zones. And for them, it is really important to know that there are still people fighting for their rights. You know, of course, saying that the European Union is an LGBTI freedom zone doesn't change anything, you know, legislatively, but it does change things in the minds of people and it does change things in our societies because, you know, the highest level of the European Union just says, well, everyone is welcome to be free here and everyone should deserve the same rights. And I think, you know, having such a declaration is just one of the very important things to do as policymakers as well.
Poland rejects inclusion of the third gender in new European Union identity cards. What does such decisions mean for a European Union country? Could this make the country's relations with the European Union worse?
Yeah, well, it just, you know, it is very, very difficult because, you know, if we want to have an inclusive system that works for everyone, then it has to be adjusted to everyone. In the Netherlands, starting from 2024, we don't have gender stated on our ID anymore. So we don't have the MFX, but we have no gender anymore. Because now you have to choose male or female, and it's really hard for trans people to change it. And if you're intersex, it's even more difficult. So that is the system we opted for in the Netherlands, to just have no gender mentioned on your passport anymore. So you can already expect that that there will be a big clash in the council when this is being discussed. But we consistently see, you know, that the European Parliament is on the side of the LGBTIQ community in terms of majorities. And I think it is very important that, you know, if we have a European identity card, it is inclusive for everyone. And, you know, not or misrepresenting people on their ID can honestly matter a life, you know, be a matter of life and death. So I think it is very important that we can continue fighting this fight. The European Parliament will definitely, you know, be pushing in trilogues for including also the trans and intersex community in this ID.
What can we as the European civil society do to influence the situation of the LGBTIQ community? Could you give us a few recommendations on how can we, the European Union citizens, make our society more inclusive and open for diversities?
Well, I think, you know, we have to start meeting each other again. I think that is one of the most powerful things we can do as European citizens, to get together, celebrate who we are and discuss how we are going to fight the next battles that are coming up, because, you know, equality is work. Reaching equality's work. So I think that is one of the things we have to continue doing. I think, you know, getting together and fighting for what's right, sharing best practices. How have you achieved certain things? How have you dealt with certain struggles? You know, just sharing this information amongst each other and truly get together as a community again. I think that is the first step we have to take as soon as we can start traveling again. It's very important that we support each other. And it's also something you see very often within the community. You know, we really try to support each other and shine a light on what is happening in communities in other countries. And we have to continue doing that.
Thank you very much for the interview. We keep our fingers crossed for the further work of the European Parliament on the issue of equality. I would also like to thank our listeners. Let's hope the European Union actions will result in the European society becoming more inclusive.